Good morning, Bowie's Creek family. It is so good to have you joining us all online this morning. Let us stand if you're able to, and let us worship our Heavenly Father as we sing of how awesome our God is. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Let us join together and worship Him. Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord, mighty in strength. You are faithful. Shout to God, all creation, how awesome is the Lord Most High. Where you send us, God, we will go. You're the answer, we want the world to know. We will trust you.
Up your praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
Hallelujah.
Well, good morning, and it's so good to have you with us this morning. I hope you're having a great week, and we're just excited to be together to worship this morning. I do have a few announcements that I want to share this morning, some important announcements. Starting next Sunday, we are moving our worship service from outside to inside, and so at 10:30, we will continue to meet at 10:30. Next Sunday, we will have worship inside our sanctuary, which also means we are going to be moving our online service to 10:30. So we'll be streaming that out live, and so you'll be able to watch that on what you're watching now on Facebook or on YouTube through the church app or the website. We do want to make a couple notes. Because there will be people in the building, there'll be people probably on the Wi-Fi and internet system, there is a chance that things could be a little slower, or if we have trouble with the internet, Everything will be recorded, and so if things do have problems, or if your computer are having trouble with streaming or anything like that, the service will be available later in the day on both of the YouTube and Facebook platforms, so you'll be able to catch that back up. But next Sunday at 10:30, again, we'll be moving our worship from outside to inside. We also want to let you know that we're asking everyone who can to be able to enter the building through the Main Street exit or entrance under the columns. If you can't, if you need to come up the ramp, or if you need that quicker entry point, you're more than welcome to do that. We're just, because of some airflow issues and other things, we're trying to get people to come in through the Main Street entrance as much as possible. Also want to remind you, we do have nursery available. If you're bringing your children to nursery, you can just have them come through the regular doors, through the fellowship hall doors, and bring them into the nursery. Do want to remind you that we are asking people that to wear their facial coverings. Those are going to be required so that we can just protect everyone as best as possible. We'll have some social distance seating as well throughout the sanctuary. So we're just asking everybody to be safe. We're getting close to the end of this thing, but we want to make sure that we protect everyone and keep everyone as safe as possible, but also be able to come together and worship. And so we're excited about that. So we hope that you will join us. I want to just say a word of testimony and a thank you. Again, last week was our yard sale, and looks like we're going to raise a little over $5,500. And we just want to, again, say thank you. Thank you to all the people who helped pull that off, put that together, all the volunteers that made that possible. So we just thank you for that. That will help fund our mission efforts moving forward. So we're excited about that. Also want to remind you that we have our fireside chat tonight at 6:30, and if you need the code or the information for that on Zoom, you can go to the event tab on the church website or the church app and get that information, and we hope that you will join us for that. As we continue this morning, I want to read out of 1 Timothy 6, beginning in verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. As we continue in our series today on people encountering Jesus, we're going to encounter a man who was trying to get more and more and more, and Jesus warned him about what that would lead to. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll continue in our worship this morning. Again, we're just grateful that you are with us this morning. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you do in our lives. God, we thank you that you provide us with what we need. God, I pray that we would not seek more than that we would seek your kingdom. And Lord, allow that and that contentment of this wonderful, abundant life given in grace, that would be sufficient in our lives, and that we would see the joy in following and pursuing you and not chasing after all this other stuff. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Well, let us stand if you're able to and would like to once again as we come together in a song of praise, as we sing of the amazing grace that Jesus Christ that broke all of the chains and our bondage to sin. As we sing, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious, dear. grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
The Lord has promised.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever. From everlasting to everlasting, He is our firm foundation, the solid rock upon which our faith and upon His church is built. So let us sing this timeless text this morning as we sing the solid rock. My hope is built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
His oath.
His oath, his covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Is he your solid rock?
When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
This morning, as we close in prayer, it's that time of year, a little earlier than normal, where our college students start heading back home, and many are in the midst of exams right now. And so we just want to pray for them. We want to pray that their summer, all the things that they're going to be doing, that God would use them, that they would have a good time, a good break away from all the things that are going on, but that they would continue to pursue the things of God. And as we look at this passage today, it is so easy for us to chase after other things. But we want our students, we want them to embrace God's will for their lives so that they can go and live with God's purpose. So let's pray together. God, we're grateful for this day. We are grateful for who you are. And Lord, we just pray for these students. God, many of them in the midst of exams right now and what has been a tough three semesters. I just pray, God, that you would renew their spirits. God, I pray that you would renew their purpose and that they would pursue you, God, that they would seek your kingdom, seek how they can be used for you to do mighty things for you, to take your mission to the ends of the world. And God, we just pray that you, Lord, you be with their parents as they reunite over the summer. I pray, God, that there would be a time of renewal there in the family. We're just so blessed to have so many of them come and be a part of our church family and our church life. And God, we just ask, Lord, that you would protect them, keep them safe. But God, most of all, we pray that they would seek your will and that, God, you would take their gifts that you have blessed them with and use them for your work in your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
If you have your Bibles this morning, if you will open them to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, as you're turning there, when you think of the word greed, I don't know what comes to your mind, but I know sort of immediately, just because I like the story and have seen it acted out on stage and have seen the movie and have read the books. When I think of greed, I think of Ebenezer Scrooge, the classic foil of Charles Dickens' The Christmas Carol. And all the sort of people in my life that I've ever encountered that I have associated with greed or seen chasing after things or treating people differently because they're on a pursuit for more and more stuff, it always kind of goes back to there. So it's that memory that kind of sticks in my mind. And so I see greed sort of as this kind of miserly older person who has all this money and pursues all of that. And surely that can't happen to me. I can't be a person of greed. Our story today is about an encounter with Jesus, a man who goes to Jesus with a complaint about someone that he apparently thinks is greedy, but yet has a hard time seeing greed in himself. Instead of a woman that we looked at last week, who was not asking Jesus for herself, but for her daughter, today we see a man who is simply seeking more for himself. He is looking out for number one. He is pursuing his own interest. He is not persistent or an advocate for someone else. In her case, her daughter, he is seeking after himself. Luke chapter 12, beginning in verse 13. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or arbitrator between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And then he told them this parable: "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, 'Well, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops.' Then he said, 'This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and I'll build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, be merry.' God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God.'" This man's pursuit blinded him to his own greed. In the perception of his brother's greed, this man was blind to the fact he was greedy. You know, I think at least conceptually, we all understand the danger of greed. As Jesus lays this out, I think we all get that. Jesus speaks against this. The Proverbs are full of it. The Bible teaches all of this stuff about greed and the pursuit of money and things. We get that conceptually. There are people out there now, probably in the prosperity gospel crowd, that may not understand the dangers of greed and chasing after. But for the most part, I think we can agree on that. But what happens in this story, I think, is a danger that we need to be on guard of. We, as Jesus warned all of the people who were listening, we have to be on guard. I know for me, in the perception, as I shared earlier, we think greed is a haves problem. Here's what I mean. We think, for the most part, that greed is a problem for those people who have a bunch of stuff and want to pursue even more stuff. Now, certainly that's a danger. If you have a lot of stuff and you keep pursuing stuff and your ambition gets on that and you can pursue more stuff, that is a danger. But it becomes a problem, no matter if we have a bunch or we don't have a bunch. Where the problem, where the danger, where we have to be on guard is when we chase after stuff instead of the mandates of God. And what God wants us to do with whatever stuff we have. It's an important problem for us to understand. And it's not just a problem for people who have stuff. It's a problem we all face. It's a greed problem that we can all have. And I know some may be sitting there saying, well, how can I be greedy? I don't have anything. Look at my bank account. Look at my house. Look at how can I be greedy? This whole story starts with somebody, it appears, who's not in the haves group. They're in the haves not group. This encounter with Jesus is just like last week. We don't know the person's name. It just identifies a person as someone in the crowd. Jesus has been teaching on hypocrisy. He's been talking about persecution, empowerment of the Holy Spirit, all of these things. And then out of the blue, this guy sort of steps up out of the crowd. Again, we don't know his name. He steps up out of the crowd. And it really seems as if what he's saying has nothing to do with what Jesus was teaching about. I've been there. You prepare a sermon, you preach the sermon, and then somebody comes up at the end and asks you a question that has absolutely nothing to do with what you're teaching. But maybe it does. Teacher, he says, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. Now the assumption in this question, because of Jewish teaching, because of the teaching that had been given to God's people, on the practicalness of inheritance, the younger brother would have received, if there was two brothers, a third of the inheritance, and the older brother would have received a double portion, or two-thirds. So if there was a $3,000 inheritance, the older brother would have got $2,000, the younger brother $1,000. And the request here in the context is that the other brother, the younger brother, the one not getting as much, is seemingly asking that Jesus tell his older brother to divide the inheritance 50-50. Now to you and I, we might quickly jump to this younger brother's side. It seems fair, right? Like, why would the older brother be able to get two-thirds and the younger brother one-third? In our mind, intellectually, we want to jump to his side and say, yeah, he's got a point. Why would this older brother be so greedy? Even if that's the instruction, why wouldn't he, with grace, just want to give part of that to his younger brother? But that's not the point here. The point here is not who's getting what money. The point is, Jesus knows the heart of the man asking the question. And he uses that question, he uses the man's heart to deal with the greater issue, and that's greed. This man seems to understand, at least perceptionally, his brother's greed. Jesus, tell him to divide the money. We can assume by the question and by the sort of demand of Jesus that his brother's not willing to do it. And yet, in his question, he's unable to see what he himself is guilty of. And so his solution, because his brother won't give him the money, his solution is to go to Jesus, one who has authority, a teacher. We don't know that he has acknowledged Jesus as anything other than a rabbi or a teacher, but he knows because a teacher has authority and would be able to proclaim some things into his brother's life, he goes to this authority figure, Jesus, and he's asking to get what he thinks he deserves. And it's important to note here, this man is not seeking understanding from Jesus. He, He's not going to Jesus and saying, is it right for me to ask for this? Is it right for my brother to keep two-thirds? Is it right in the law? What does it mean? He's wanting Jesus to get him money. That's all this is about. That's at the heart of this. And it's a warning for us. It's a warning about our faith. It's a warning about what we pursue. It's a warning about what we desire out of life. And that leads to the next point. Jesus is not the authority of our personal agenda. In this story, Jesus makes a profound statement that if we're not careful, we jump right ahead and move on past it. And we go right to this parable and we start looking at it. But look at verse 14. Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or arbitrator between you?" I think two things are really important here. Because I think if we look deeply enough in our own lives, we can see ourselves here. First, Jesus does not take the bait of this argument. I'm going to maybe upset some folks, and I don't mean to, but I want to make sure we understand this. Because oftentimes we're guilty of this. Jesus does not want to, he will not wade off into this man's personal agenda. Jesus is not going to walk into this situation where the man calls out from the crowd and put his stamp on this man's personal agenda. Jesus knows the heart of the man asking the question. He knows your heart. He knows my heart. We're going to see that in a few seconds and we'll get there. This man clearly is coming to Jesus to add an authority to his sinful behavior. And in this case, the sinful behavior is his greed. Jesus does not give the man what he wants. He does not put his authority on this man's personal agenda. And for you and I here, there's a lesson. Too many Christians are too quick to jump in with both feet on things like this. When somebody comes to us, what seems to be a grievance, man, the lure of drama is too much in too many people's lives. It's powerful. And what often happens, because people maybe come to you and are seeking authority on their personal agenda, and it's a drama-filled story like this one, and we want to jump in 2 feet, both feet. Man, you're right. Your brother should give you the money. You deserve it. I can't believe your brother. And on and on and on. Man, I know what the rule is, but it's 2021. I would march right over to your brother and I would demand you get that money. That's yours. Too often, people like to stir the pot because we let our emotions get involved. We let our own sin get involved because we have our own pursuits. We let our own issues get in the way. Instead of seeing what the reality is. You see, Jesus knew the heart of this man. He knew that the heart of this man was really no different than what he was putting on the heart of his brother. The problem wasn't the percentage of the inheritance. The problem was deeper than that. The inheritance, the percentage, his desire, that was a symptom of the problem, not the problem. The second thing here is that Jesus knew the problem, he got to it, and he called it out. You see, these two brothers didn't need arbitration. They didn't need a judge. They needed repentance. Notice what Jesus says. Watch out. It's an alert. It's watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed or covetousness, whichever translation you might have. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Jesus is telling this man, he's telling everyone who was listening, and there seemed to be a crowd there, and we don't know how many were around, but probably his brother was there because he came and asked Jesus on the spot to do it, that all kinds of greed is the problem. Whether the older brother was full of greed and didn't want to share, whether it was the younger brother's greed of wanting more, whether anybody else in the crowd was full of greed and pursuing things, Jesus said all kinds of greed. Be on guard. You see, when we make life about getting stuff, it doesn't matter whether we're getting a third, whether we're getting a half, whether we're getting two-thirds. If stuff is the pursuit of your life, you're in trouble. Be on guard. You see, this problem was not a math problem. It wasn't a traditional view of inheritance problem. The problem here is the one that we read earlier. It was greed. And we know, because Paul wrote this and we read it earlier, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, it says, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. This man was wanting Jesus to put authority on his personal agenda, and his personal agenda was rooted in sin. Man, I get asked this all the time. People want me to weigh in on their personal agenda. People have something that they are pursuing or they desire, and they want to come to me and have me, because I'm a pastor, put sort of a spiritual authority behind their argument. Not too long ago, I had someone come, "Pastor, I saw a man the other day who was asking for something on the side of the street. I didn't give him anything because he looked like he was able-bodied and probably could get a job and work. Don't you agree, Pastor, that I did the right thing?" And I counseled that person. If you thought that you did the right thing, you wouldn't be in my office asking me to put a spiritual stamp on it. You see, the man here was not interested, as often we aren't, in an arbitrator, a judge, or even seeking the wisdom of God. He was interested in someone, Jesus, rubber stamping an authority on his problem of sin, his problem of greed. And Jesus will not advocate for sin, nor should we. Jesus refused. Jesus did what he always did. He took this man's motives, he turned them, and he preached biblical truth that leads to abundant life in Christ. But if we don't learn of the peril of any sin, if we don't listen to what others who are godly are speaking into our lives, if we're not willing to accept that counsel, then we move off into this place of pursuit of ungodly and sinful things. So to make this clear, Jesus moves on and he tells a parable. Jesus gives a clear picture of what the emptiness of life looks like when we are motivated by greed. Jesus often would tell stories because it pierced to the heart of people. They could identify with it. He tells a parable. This parable, a man, a rich farmer, Jesus says. He's already rich. The ground, the story that Jesus tells is not about him becoming rich. It's about adding to his wealth. So he ponders the question this man does. The ground has produced all of this stuff. I mean, he's in abundance. The harvest is just overflowing. So he said, what will I do? All this stuff, all this harvest, I have no place for it. And in this question, we see the problem revealed immediately. You see, the process thinking here, it is from a worldview that the rich farmer had. From the very minute that the farmer understands that he has this abundant crop, this overflowing harvest, he doesn't ask, what would God have me do with this abundance? That's not his first question. His first question, his first indication of where his mind is, his worldview is where will I store this stuff for me? Wondering what God would have him do with it doesn't even cross his mind. You see, the thought process goes straight to himself, straight to the pursuit of more things. The solution to the abundance is not taking God's truth into account one bit. He's only considering himself. That's the very root of greed. When everything we have is about pursuing more and pursuing more for ourselves. Remember, Jesus said when asked, what's the greatest commandment? He said, the first is that we love God with everything, our heart, soul, mind, and strength. The second is to love our neighbors as ourselves. The man in this story was not worried about what God wanted. He wasn't worried about his neighbor. He was worried about him. This man, this worldview, was a pursuit of storage and buildings for self-use. And he decides, I'll tear down my barns. The ones that I have now that can't store, I'll tear them down and I'll build bigger ones. And when I build those bigger barns, I can take all this produce and I can put it in there and I can store it, all this grain, and I can leave it there. And then I can sit back and I can eat, drink, and be merry. But then Jesus said, God came to him and said, you fool, tonight you're going to die. You're going to die, and who's going to get all this stuff that you built these bigger barns for? Who's going to get all this stuff that you prepared for yourself? Jesus said, this is what happens. This is what happens when we store up things for ourselves and are not rich toward God. This parable gets misused all the time. People say you shouldn't save for retirement. People say you shouldn't retire at all. People say you shouldn't have money. You shouldn't have wealth. All these things. But here's the bottom line. If we take this story in the context in which it's given, the context of why Jesus gives this story is a warning against greed and all kinds of it. You see, when we make money and we make more money and we make more money and we do so at the expense of what God's desire for our life is, when our money becomes more important than the people God brings in our life, when our money becomes more important than the pursuit of God's kingdom around the world, when our money becomes the thing that drives us every bit of the day, that's the problem. We might find ourselves with full barns, yes. But we also may find ourselves with no real friends and spiritual emptiness. In the context of the story, Jesus goes on. He goes on and talks about self-reliance and worry. Jesus goes on and tells them not to worry about how you're going to eat, how... He said, you pursue God, verse 31, seek the kingdom, and you're going to have what you need. Jesus reminds them of when he sent them out. He reminds them when they seek the world, that God, when God provides, we don't have to worry. And he uses all these examples. And in verse 30, he says, the pagan world runs after all of these things. All these things that people pursue, the pagan world chases them. And the Father knows that you need some of those things. And if you seek Him first, He will provide them for you. Does this mean that we all need to become monks and go live in the desert? No. Does this mean that we all need to go out and live by the road and live in tents? No. Does it mean I can't go on vacation or have fun times with my family? No. But what it means is that first and foremost, our pursuits must be the kingdom of God. That means our reaction to things, our initial response cannot be, how can this stuff benefit me? But rather, what would God have me do with what He's blessed me with or what He has given me? And for some, that may not be much. And for some, it may be a whole lot. But the first response can't be, I need to build bigger barns. First response has to be, how would God use me? How would God use this stuff? Jesus makes it clear that our first pursuit is not stuff for ourselves. It's Him. It's His mission. It's His work. And then He will be faithful to provide what we need. You see, this man encountered Jesus hoping above all hopes that Jesus would just give him more stuff. And what Jesus gave him was the truth. He gave him the way to pursue God and find the true value of life. So let me ask you today, what's your pursuit? What are you chasing after? Are you spending your time, your energy, pursuing your things? Are you on an endless pursuit to not just fill up the barns you have, but to build bigger barns and fill those up? Maybe you spend a lot of your time looking around and seeing what your brother or your sister or your friend or your neighbor or your fellow church member or fellow community member, what they have, and you're wanting stuff after stuff after stuff. Can I just tell you something? When Jesus says, be on guard of all kind of greed, whether you have or you don't have, over the years I have seen people come into my life, and I have seen people who pursue stuff. And yeah, you know, people look on their lives and they have all this stuff, or they have all these things, or they have this or they have that. And man, people think, gosh, their life is so easy. And then they get behind the doors of my office. And I realize their lives are miserable because they're not pursuing God. You can have a big bank account. You can have lots of houses, cars, boats, whatever. And if people are really honest, if that stuff is not in a pursuit of God, if you're not using that for the kingdom, it's lonely and it's miserable. That's not what God asks us to pursue. So today I want to challenge you. Just a simple verse, Jesus said it. Seek Him. Seek His kingdom. And all we need, that will be provided to you. I know that's not popular. I know it's not what people tell you. It's not what commercials sell you. It's not what the world seems to put. In fact, we got to have the biggest, the best, and all the other stuff. With all the sincerity in my heart, I want to urge you, if you'll just seek the things of God, you'll find the joy of abundant life in Christ. And one day when you leave this world into eternity, you will be able to be surrounded by all the people who are laying their crowns at the feet of Jesus, and you'll understand fully. I believe this with all my heart. You'll understand this fully, what it means to have life surrendered to Christ. Would you seek first God's kingdom today? Whatever else you're pursuing, lay that stuff aside and seek God first. God, I pray today we would be people who are faithful to you. God, I know the temptation is to seek after the world's offerings, to seek better this and better that and bigger this and bigger that. But God, I pray that the big things that we will seek is your kingdom. God, may we find our purpose in following you. May we find our life in your life. God, I pray that we would be people who are fully surrendered to you, who pursue you relentlessly, who love others generously. God, may we be the people you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. In just a few minutes, we're going to sing our hymn of invitation, and my contact information will be on the screen. I'd love for you to reach out to me. I'd love to pray with you. This is not easy. It's countercultural, but it's what God pursues for us. So reach out to me. I'd love to pray with you and talk with you more about this. Amen.
Are you hurting?
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he one? Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. wonderful. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. As you wait for the crown, tell the world of the treasure you found.
As we leave this morning, again, I just want to remind you, next Sunday, if you're watching online, everything will be at 10:30 instead of 11 o'clock. And again, if there's any kind of technical issues, the service will be made available a little bit later in the day on both of those platforms. But as we leave here today, I want to encourage you to go. Go as God's people. Go as God's people desiring God's things. Go as God's people desiring God's thing, seeking His kingdom, and allow God to work and bless you in your life so that you can be a servant, an ambassador for His message to all the world. God bless you. Have a great week. And I'll see you next Sunday, hopefully inside here. Amen.